You know, if someone has good physical health, the results will be such things as a lot of energy, a nice low steady pulse rate, good blood pressure readings and low cholesterol and all the rest. But you can't just choose to have a lot of energy today. You can't just choose to lower your pulse. What we choose has to do with our diet, exercise, sleep choices, and then the physical health comes as the result, if you will, as the fruit of making the right choices. Well, we're talking about the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, spiritual health, if you prefer. And we are looking now at how we can produce what we saw last week, the fruit of the Spirit, the love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, and all the rest that should be the mark of the Christian. Well, step one is pretty simple. You got to be born again. Simple and yet profound, I guess. But that's the starting point, because we are talking about what the Holy Spirit does in our lives. And one must have a spiritual birth to be indwelt by the Holy Spirit of God. And so you must believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and that He rose from the dead for you. And put your trust in Him alone as your Savior, not your own religious works or traditions or any such thing. Now, having been born again, the next step, and we looked at this last week, is we need to, by faith, recognize that one of the things Jesus accomplished on the cross was to put to death the passions and desires of our flesh, of our old sin nature. We still have the old sin nature, and we will until the day we go to glory. But the old sin nature does not have to rule over us anymore. And the reason it doesn't have to is because of what Jesus accomplished on the cross. Now, we need to accept that by faith. And I know that the word faith gets attached to a lot of stuff that it really shouldn't today. For example, someone says, I'm healthy. No, you're not. You're sick. You need to go see a doctor. No, I'm healthy. I'm healthy. I have faith that I'm healthy. This name it and claim it kind of thing. Just speak it out and it becomes true. No, that's not faith. Because you're not healthy. Now, you may have faith that God, if He so desires, might heal you. That's a totally different subject. But right now, you're sick. You know, a guy says, I'm rich. No, you're not. You can barely pay your bills. I mean, that's reality. So don't label denial faith. But you see, what we're talking about here is reality. This is what Jesus did on the cross for us. And so we are commanded to reckon ourselves dead with Christ on the cross so that those passions and desires of the flesh do not rule over us. That's an important step. And then, as we saw last week, as we concluded, get in line with the Holy Spirit. Single file right behind Him as He leads us. Now, we go to verse 26 of chapter 5. I left this out last week because it's another hinge verse. It does properly conclude what was said in chapter 5, but it also serves as an introduction to the verses that are going to come in chapter 6. So we held on to it till today. So verse 26 of chapter 5 of Galatians says, "Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another." The provoke, a word meaning to challenge to a fight or a contest. And we can do that outside of the physical realm with our theological debates and arguments and just provoking in that sense. And of course, envying was seen as one of the works of the flesh there in verse 21. This was a problem for these Galatian churches. They lacked love. And love right there is the very first fruit of the Spirit listed for us. Fruit of the Spirit is love. And that's indicative of a lack of love when there's provoking and envying of each other. See, the thing about being conceited, it's a totally misplaced pride. Now, sometimes people think the word pride always is evil in and of itself. That's really not true. If you're a parent, for example, and your child does something right, you can be proud of your child for a decision. That's not sinful or evil to feel proud that your child made the right call. He withstood a temptation or whatever it was. Likewise, if you set a goal for a worthy accomplishment and you complete it, you can be proud that you did something that you set your mind to that was hard. So we don't want to totally destroy the idea of the word. But pride, when there's no base or substance to it, is really what conceit is all about. There's an old hymn that begins the first line, "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride." That's the way to stay humble, is to stay focused on the cross. And we are going to see that theme, that idea, repeated several times in these verses to come. So we're talking about how we can develop a spirit-filled life, and this starts us off right here. Well, don't provoke each other, don't envy each other, don't be conceited.